brave and dedicated João Nunes arrived in Columbus via Snowzilla. Did you know it's called Snowzilla? He dodged the blizzard, flew from Lisbon to Newark, where of course there was no plane to Columbus. So he flew to Cleveland instead. There was a plane to Cleveland. And there he rented a car to drive to Columbus and arrived yesterday morning at 2:30, right? So indeed, brave and dedicated. João Nunes is the 2016 Glimcher Professor. He is a landscape architect, the founder and CEO of the Lisbon-based landscape architecture firm PROAP, which includes a large group of professionals who work in cross-disciplinary team format. João develops the firm's conceptual and creative approach to design. He leads project development and defines the strategic orientation of PROAP's research, and he writes, and that's important, I think. Many academic landscape architectural and educational institutions undermine experience-based knowledge in the sense that landscape architects do not hold academic positions. So João's effort to articulate and define PROAP's research in the production of landscape architecture is a fundamental and effective contribution to current discourse. While at the core of PROAP's built projects lies a surgical determination of the relationship between ground and infrastructure, between organic and inorganic matter, João's intellectual preoccupations occupy a more philosophical space. The notion of time is very much at the core of PROAP's design research. João emphasizes the importance of building a continuity of culture. He acknowledges and explores the notion of what he calls large conformation times in landscape architecture, which are very different from architecture. So these conformation times is, you know, you plant a tree and it's a stick, is very different from building a building with a completion date. So very large conformation times. He addresses time as related to effects of and potential of decay and erosion. And decay and erosion, he means that more conceptually than literally, even though the literal content is also important in this understanding. He states that landscape architects work with different consistencies in time and need to be working with different time approaches simultaneously. And therefore, he acknowledges the need for different arguments to build architectonic space and the exploration of notational techniques. Outside the notion of time, investigative approaches are related to the bridging of scales, linking the construction detail to the scale of the territory, refining the relation, the design tools of intuition versus analytical research, which he calls enemies, interstitial spaces as landscape strategy, reclamation of agricultural dignity, entropy and empathy in natural systems, and finally, he expresses a resistance to image-based media which supports the erosion of content. And this was a subject we discussed at length yesterday. João holds a degree in agronomics and a master's degree in landscape architecture from the ETSAB in Barcelona. He's a full professor at the Academy of Architecture in Mendrisio and teaches at the Instituto Superior de Agronomia of Lisbon, the Politecnico di Milano, and the Alghero Faculty of Architecture. I do think he leads a triple life, at least, but he has admitted to us that he sleeps very little. He said it's a waste of his time. I would agree to that. He has been visiting professor at Harvard, UPenn, IUAV, Universidad de Navarra, Berkeley, and the École Nationale Supérieure du Paysage in Versailles. In 2010, a monograph was published summarizing the approach, philosophy, and projects of the first 25 years of his office. And in 2011, he co-authored a book titled Lost Competitions. Please help me welcome João Nunes.
Thank you. Very kind. Okay. Is the voice okay? Yeah? How do I get through this? Okay. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for receiving me. Thank you for this very generous presentation. And thank you for the honor of being here today, trying to share with you some ideas, some concepts, and trying to illustrate those with some images that I got out of some of our projects. I have structured this in a two-part presentation with a more kind of theoretical introduction, and then with a sequence of projects that should be a clear illustration of what I said first, if I got my point. And I always exaggerate with the number of slides, so I have slides that could do enough for a 5-hour talk. As I only have one, I will probably squeeze it a little bit and go jumping over some projects, but give me the opportunity of selecting those as they come, because my will would be to show them all and to talk about all with you and to wait to have some feedback from you from the things that I was sharing, but probably it will not be possible. So as they come, I will try to choose and to jump some of those and to go further deep on others, okay? So I will point out for 1 hour 1 hour time. I don't want to abuse of your patience and physical resistance, but I would really like to save at least 5 minutes or 10 minutes to have some dialogue, to have some possible questions and comments. I don't know if it's in the tradition of these lectures, but I would very much like to do so. So thank you. Well, the idea how things merge. The idea has to do with this image. We are living in a fantastic moment of the world where actually lots of things get together, and they are things that are apart in time and in space. They are magically together, and they are like touching and creating incredibly new opportunities and incredibly new situations. This is a photograph I did some years ago in Mexico City, and I think that it really illustrates this incredible moment. I think that generally people have this kind of temptation to think that we were better first, and some kind of nostalgic approach to the past. But I think that we are really living an incredible moment, and I'm very enthusiastic about the times that we are living with all the difficulties that we know we have. But we really did something in the past, all these thousands of years, to get to this moment and to get to this condition of life and of thinking. And I think that it is very important to appreciate this and to celebrate this condition of being contemporary. And well, this incredible situation creates this overlapping of in different times and different situations, like this Ellen's photograph, or this one in Syria. And this guy, he has this eye for catching these images that synthesize the juxtaposition of strangely apart things. So they began like they become like a narrative about the incredible conditions that we live today. So they mixed different cultures, different times, different ideas, different purposes. And he's a photographer, so he really talks clearly when he illustrates these ideas through these beautiful images. Well, we are all sons of the modern, and we have these ideas very, very deep in our minds and in our bodies. And in one hand, we were born in this idea that machines would save the world, and we were born in this fantastic conviction that man could save the world and could save himself. And then, strangely, there is a moment where everything seems to get destroyed, and these convictions get loose, and we start to doubt on that possibility, and we immediately shift from this celebration of the man possibility of solving everything to the other point, to the conviction of guilt and the strange construction of a moral that corresponds to the possibility of attaching a man-touched things with spoiled and degraded things. And this is a strange moral condition to work as an architect. And I think that one of the most important things is to recover the conviction in man-made work and in the possibility of building the marvels of the future. And I think that this conviction very much animates our thoughts and our souls when we work. And when we look at these modern images, we see like the construction of a very sharp limit between man-made things and nature. And nature is like a strange conceptual thing that really does not correspond to anything in concrete. But the important thing is to sharply define this frontier, this borderline between one thing and the other. And there are many ways of telling this, but each of these images is clearly talking about this condition. There is a man-made object, and then there is like a universe where this thing is stick, and there is a clear borderline between one and the other. And I think that nowadays we can probably consider that it is much more interesting to think how anthropic worlds, how cultural and nature merge and create different new things than to stand out how they are apart and how the borderlines are designed. So I think that nowadays, and mainly in landscape architecture, the construction of an idea of a merged universe, of something that results from the mixing of cultural and nature in the construction of a new thing, is really a fantastic way of approaching what we do, who we are, and what the future will be. So I think that some of these images, they talk about this in a more creative or in a more catastrophic kind of way, but I think that they can really transmit the idea that I would try to consider the basic one of our projects, which is to look at landscape as the construction of this third thing, as this thing that is clearly working as a working as a natural metabolism, but it is, after all, man-made or man-controlled. And I think landscape is pretty much this thing, this incredible machine that is able to work as a natural thing, but it is, after all, man-made or man-contaminated, it man-touched. And it is a marvelous thing, the fact that we are able to enter into the skin of these movements, into the skin of these fantastic processes and become a part of them, still making them work in the directions that we want to become profitable to our bias of transforming environment, which is actually one of our more specific characteristics. The only way we have to survive is to transform and manipulate environment, because we are ridiculously weak when we think about our physical conditions to survive in environment. We don't run, we don't have natural weapons to defend ourselves, we don't fly, we swim like a stone. We are totally stupid physically when we compare ourselves, even in terms of resistance. We have dogs, the resistance of dogs' bones and of the resistance that they have to physical stress and to physical pain is unbelievably bigger than ours, and they are tiny little fragile animals. So we are really weak. We are really weak, and that's our strength. We are so weak that we have to change things and manipulate them and give them another shape around us in order to survive. Well, modernism develops these thoughts, and they are generous thoughts. After all, even considering this fascist context, there is always some kind of generosity, there is always some kind of idea of a service, of idea of putting themselves in the service of community, which I think is the second very important idea. And when we get detached from this idea, something really strange happens. These are the works of Florio Puente. Florio Puente is a Swiss artist, he's a photographer, and then he manipulates the photographies by taking away everything that is anthropic from the image. So it's a very strange exercise of skin cleaning of the image, taking away all the human and all the anthropic signs, all the anthropic marks. But at the same time, here he does another trick, because he leaves the presence of the anthropic construction on the reflection on the water. And it is somehow, this is the real image, somehow it is strange, because it has to do with this kind of moral, where the limit of anthropic world and natural world is very strangely confusional. And actually he takes away housing and infrastructure, but then he believes that forest is actually natural, which is not. Here it is totally manipulated from the planting systems to the trees that they are planting. So it is at the same time naive by considering the position of this frontier line between anthropic world. Well, it is funny because, for instance, this is San Moritz, and this is San Moritz also. So he just erased San Moritz from the map, which is a fantastic thing to do. Another idea is the conviction that there is like a structural way of building landscape, which is recognizable when we analytically look at how things were built from the geological beginning to anthropic layers. And there is this idea of overlaying signs, the first signs that are totally absent of any kind of human responsibility, and they are a geological kind of foundation of the world, layering the first topographic elements. Then there is like a entropic energy that starts to mill this thing and to create by erosion soil and changing shapes and introducing new relations and introducing new marks, new shapes, new signs. Then there is a colonization of those new soils by plants that create habitats for animals, and each one of these new actors of this story, they introduce a new layer of signs by the fact that they are alive and by the fact that they move and by the fact that they touch ground. And then at the top there is a very, very thick system of layers that correspond to the very fast succession of traces that generations, human generations, imprint in the world. And this has have to do with the fact that each generation has a dream, has an idea, has a technological possibility of shaping environment in different ways. So we actually sign our generational condition with the signs that correspond very directly to the marks of our gestures, to the footsteps of our ways, to the way that we read the relation with nature, to the way that we imprint the signs that represent very directly the values upon which we live. So the metaphor of the palimpsest, and this is a palimpsest, this is one of a very famous palimpsest, it's the Archimedes palimpsest, where a text by Archimedes was erased, and palimpsest means precisely that in ancient Greek, to erase, to be able to write again, and it was a technique that they had more ideas than parchment, so they had to recycle them, and this is funny because the guys that were erasing things, they were not able to erase them completely. So there is this shadow, there is this ghost of the old text that is kept there. And this guides the new writer to articulate a different position in relation to the old writing. So this means that even when we get the palimpsest metaphor from art historians or from urbanists, where they actually mean totally tabula rasa to reimprint a new set of signs, we are actually never doing that in landscape construction because we are always reacting to something that happens in the last layer that was there. So we are actually not erasing everything and creating a new layer every time, but we are building a system, we are building a building, we are creating a very complex building during time, which is actually what landscape is. So when we think about landscape as a visual fact and as a spatial fact, we have to add this idea that it is also about time. And if landscape in some dictionaries is referred as a piece of space that we can hold in a look, and I think that it should be more than a piece of space, a piece of time that we can hold in a look. So the other idea is that through this imprinting of successions of marks that corresponds to the emergencies of each moment of life, to the manifestations of the dreams, of the wills of each generations, there are other systems that still correspond to the manifestation of other continuities, of other processes that are still acting. So the results are complex, and these are metaphorical images that I collect, and I think that they are very interesting on showing this completely unstoppable process of changing, and I think that this gives us an idea that every project that we make in landscape, it's something that has a beginning millions and millions of years ago, and we don't know where it's going to end. So we are kind of getting in between times, and we are kind of taking advantage of the incredible gift that is the time of our lives to be able to hold future in one hand and past in the other. So this really gives a meaning to what we are doing here, because we are actually creating like a chain between time, and we are actually holding times together in order to be able to build this idea of continuity, which is a very strong idea when we think about humanity as just one thing. So clearly this overlapping of things, they create very unbelievable images. For instance, this is the mark of a support of a motorcycle in Milano. And the guy, it's a storytelling thing, so when you start reading these things, you get amazed with the results. This guy was imprinting the very same support of the motorcycle 250 times in 2 square meters. So this means that he was repeating the same gesture, the putting the motorcycle in the same position, 2 or 3 centimeters apart, and it's an amazing record of persistence, of repetition, of routine, of that guy that was working there or visiting the girlfriend or something like that. Well, these are the, I'm sorry, this is in a, these are the images from the caves that were famous in Werner Herzog film, The Cave of the Lost Dreams. I don't know if you saw it. It's Chauvet, and it's in the French Alps. And they are extraordinary images, and they talk about continuity. This cave was lived as a ritual cave for 20,000 years. So it is already something amazing about continuity, because to be able to kept a ritual place active for 20,000 years, it means an incredible stability in the functioning of a community. But then the story is also fantastic, because after those 20,000 years, there was like a earthquake probably, and the entrance of the cave was sealed, so nobody entered there for other 20,000 years. So these images that are 40,000 years old, which is already something extraordinary, because we imagine that a guy that lived 40,000 years ago was some kind of a monkey. And on the contrary, he was a very, very, very good artist. But then the story is more amazing than that, because when they started to analyze deeply the dating of each image, they realized that those images that we look as something that is like an artistic composition, they were not made in the same moment, and they are like 1,000 or 2,000 years apart. So this means that in this ritual cave, there was this work of art which was taken by each generation as something that was obviously marvelous, but they add things, and they were able to look at it as something that was dynamical, and the responsibility was precisely to add things and to make them become more and more beautiful. So this very conservatory idea that we now have in Europe, that is trying to look at landscape as something that you can put on a glass showcase, and that you can seal and congeal, is very naive and very strange, because actually we have to do that. We have to understand the marvelous thing that we have, and we have to understand that it is dynamical, and that our responsibility is to add things, is to be able to get this incredible coherence, and at a certain moment people will look at it and they will find that it was a beautiful piece of art that was made in one moment, but it was not. It's a construction in time, it's a collective construction in time and in space. And I think this is a beautiful idea, because this is an image from L'Enfant Sauvage, de François Truffaut, and this is a film from the 70s, and it's a film that talks about this little guy that was lost as a baby, and he was raised by wolves, so he was acting like a wolf. And this is something that always fascinated me, because in the 80s in Portugal, there was a similar situation with a little girl that was raised by a crazy mother with the chickens, and she actually was a chicken, and she believed that she was a chicken. She was picking the ground, and she was eating corn and things like that. And even 3 years after, when she was found out and she was recovered from that, and she was cared, she couldn't do normal things 3 years after. She was 8 and she couldn't talk and she couldn't physically act like a normal human being. This means that our individual condition that is so exaggeratedly celebrated is much more fragile than we really think. And we are actually dependent on this collective construction to be what we are. Otherwise, we are just what the context makes of us, which is a very fragile condition when we think about it. So this contemporary thinking that individual is a very important thing is quite strange, because we are empty containers for information that we get from context. And if we are in a cultural context, we become man. If we are between chickens, we become not a chicken, but a monster, because we are a very, very strange chicken. And continuity means this, and means the way that we have to build things and to juxtapose times, and or to overlap times. This is the cloisters of the Cathedral of Lisbon, where 5 cities are overlapping, telling about 5 times of the life of this city. And it is really a fantastic story when we start to read it. The causes of destruction are really not important. What is really important is the fact that we are still living there. A city is still there, 2,050 years after the first layer of constructions. Okay. The other thing that I think is important in terms of describing landscape is the fact that this continuity, this systemic characteristic, is obviously temporal, but it is also spatial. This is the source of the Tejo, which is the river that that flows in Lisbon. So that little thing becomes this thing. And this is extraordinarily important, because it means that our work and our universe of work, we touch things that look small and insignificant, but then they are multiplied on this system construction by factors that make them become very, very important. So it's about humility and responsibility. It's about placing ourselves in an attitude position that is, I think is really interesting. Well, then we are also touching something that is dynamical. So it's very difficult to put it in a dome and to look at it through glass, because it's always changing. And this has to do with what we do, how we do it. How can we work in a reality that is always changing? This is the Mississippi. It's a mapping that tries to stand out the positions along 120 years. But then other rhythms are overlaying this one, like seasons, and transformations that are very, very hard to believe. This is an exercise that was done by a good friend, Duarte Belo, who is a Portuguese photographer, and he picked up the book by a geographer, Orlando Ribeiro, and he returned to the very same positions that he photographed in the 30s, and he made them again 80 years later, and the result is quite amazing, because you know that thing where we were better before. It's really not true, because the spatial quality and the ecological diversity of the spaces that he photographed is 100 times better now. And this is very easy to explain, because in the 30s, the level of life, the economics, were very, very low, and people were surviving because they had goats and they had sheep at home, and the milk of the goats were important because the kids could survive because they had this milk. So this means that everybody had goats around, and this means that nothing could grow because it was immediately eaten. And this means a social change. This means a very important social change, and this means an incredible improvement in terms of environmental quality of the country. It also means that we started to have forest fires that we obviously didn't have on that time. So, again, getting metaphorical, this is a work by Irina Werning, and what she does is a very strange thing. I think it's really frightening. She tries to go to people and she photographs them exactly in the same position of an old photograph that they have. And I think that this is exactly what happens with landscape. And we really don't get that feeling, but everything is changing around us. And if we close our eyes for 20 years or 30 years, we really see that. We just don't see it because it happens every day. Okay. So I will try to present several projects around this idea of how things merge, about time, about the idea of continuity, and about the marvelous work that we actually do. And I start, this is Lisbon, most beautiful city in the world. And this is the location of the park Teji Trancão. It is the result of a collaboration that we had with the George Hargreaves studio in San Francisco. And we ran together for the master plan competition. And after we won the master plan competition, we went through another competition for the project. And George was not attending this one because he was very concentrated, I think, in the Sydney Olympics that he was just winning on that moment. So we were left alone developing the project, which was really funny because it was like getting something that is still very formalist and trying to make it become more close to our kind of arguments. So it was a good exercise. And the story that I think is important, well, this is the site in the 60s, and it is an agricultural site, basically dominated by drainage problems, showing a clear limit between this site with drainage problems that are drained through very important campaigns that are obviously state-controlled and that build big-size property, so latifundium, and then the old grounds with no drainage problems that correspond to the design of a very different pattern of landscape with another shape, with another size, corresponding to other kind of cultivations. Here we have olive trees and probably some fruit cultivations and orchards and things like that. Well, in the 80s, the very same site erased completely any sign of agriculture, and those things were replaced by urban peripheral facilities like a landfill, a waste sewage water treatment plant, and other stinkies. They were. It was a 80s policy to put all the stinkies together in the suburbs of the cities, and there was a military deposit. We had a war in the 70s and the 60s. There was a war in Africa, trying to keep the colonies. So there were those independence movements, and the people were actually fighting. And Portuguese would go there with guns and cars. So all that material was kept here when it became unusable. So it was a very strange place in the 80s, and I really knew it on this time. And this is the image of the first. Of the first phases of the park construction. And it is interesting because if it is true that landscape is the imprinting of the signs of the everyday's life of communities, then it is also true that looking at landscape you can have like a portrait of that community, and you can exactly think, see what they were thinking, what their values were, and it is right like that, because in the first images you can guess that Lisbon was in the 60s a very provincial kind of city, very close to rural kind of life, and people were moving around with the vegetables out, getting out of the bags, and it was really like that. And then in the 80s there was like a fever of getting urban and developing all those facilities is the clear sign of that. And here it's like cleaning the conscience. Well, everything is replaced by the most demagogical argument of all, a park. So it is the perfect portrayal of the values of all these moments in the life of Portuguese community. Well, however, the design was based in the structure that was presenting two strong statements that were occupying our minds on that moment. One was the overlaying argument, which was very clearly applied here because we were kind of defining a clear overlapping of a new condition of this place, designed with a very sharp and clear geometry, to the reconstruction of what was before. I mean reconstruction, because this kind of natural edge was totally artificial rebuilt, because it was totally destroyed, and you can see it here by the construction yard of the bridge, which occupied practically everything here. This is a very big bridge. It's like a 16 and a half kilometer long, and it was precast, and the pieces were carried in barges to the mounting points, and each one of those pieces was casted here. So this was like a factory, and the soil conditions were very, very much changed, and everything here was destroyed. So we actually rebuilt this edge, this natural kind of edge, in order to be able to show the overlapping geometrical new layer of the park. And it is kind of, I think that this is something that you students will see. When we have the opportunity of doing the first projects, we get so exciting about the opportunity to state out things that things get really schematic, like manifestos. And they are not really elegant, because things are like in the eye. And then with time, we start to get a little bit more elegant about the way that we tell those things. In the beginning, we are very preoccupied with the fact that they should be readable, they have to be visible, so they get too visible. And then there was this, for instance, one of the ways of showing this overlapping thing is the fact that this path that here is strongly based, firmly based on ground, suddenly it detaches from ground and it just flies over the other layer, showing what happens when we get the second layer out of under the feet of people. So there are so very clearly clear ways of showing the idea, perhaps too clear. The second one is about process and time, and it was a preoccupation that we had, because we were like saying, well, landscape is about dynamics, landscape is a process, landscape is a going on thing. But then the projects were really still done like Lenotre did them, and we were like designing things, and we gave that design to the gardener, and the gardener was copying the design, replacing ink with edges or with the contact between grass and herbaceous. And we said, well, where is the process? What are you doing? What are you telling people? And we were like uncomfortable about this contrast between what we were saying and what we were really doing. So we were always looking for the opportunity to get an argument where we could really talk about the process. And here it was, because the second characteristic of the park was that it was a topographical construction, and topography was meant to solve many problems of the park and to organize spatially the park in order to get a condition where the flatness of the surface was not telling too much about it whenever you got there. So we were like adding complexity and trying to hide things from people and to create a total different condition where when we were here, and then when views were opening, when as we get to the margin of the river. So topography was important. And it was organized in a system. Well, these are images from what was happening there before. These are images from the expo construction yards. Well, this is the park from the tower. It's a SOM tower that is now being turned into an hotel. This is the moment where the path flies and reveals what was under. And you can see the topographic system that designs this land, the system of landforms. And the fact that landforms were like that creates an incredible opportunity, because those forms were, this is north, south, north on this side and south on this side. So this means that each one of these landforms were in place in a position where they could get the maximum radiation on one side and the minimum radiation on the other. So we were like putting together the two extreme conditions where we could actually create a process. So this means that if we were applying two different kinds of vegetation, adding, radicalizing this contrast, if we were working with irrigation, if we were working with slope, each gesture of the project would add more differences to the conditions that vegetation would experiment in the different phases of each landform. So this means that even without maintenance, the sign would be kept on, and this is exactly what we were trying to guess. After this project, we worked a lot with other things like wind, like salinity, like irrigated, non-irrigated, as arguments to work this kind of process. So it was like an important moment to understand this possibility and to jump on it and to start kind of a research line where design could be confirmed by a process. And it was nice, because it was like being able to open the door of nature and to understand that if you really get to build a project where you invent this kind of metabolism, then it is something that at a certain moment doesn't belong to you. It's no longer our project. It belongs to something. It belongs to everybody. But it's less ours, which was exactly what we were trying to find. Okay. I move very fast. There are interesting details, but those I will tell you some other time. Okay. This is about interstitial spaces and about interstitious. They can be spatial or temporal. So we are always between these structures, and they are both spatial and temporal. And this is interesting because it's precisely about a gap in time. This competition was in Geneva. This is the site of another competition we just won. And this is the site for an installation. And this was about working in the edge of the city and working in a moment where a big plan was being applied here. So this area that was agricultural production would not be more agriculture, it would become urban. And they were trying to point out this condition of the changing from agriculture to urban. So they were proposing how to do it, how to find a way of creating an installation that should be on for 4.5 months in order to point out the fact that this space was suspended between these two conditions, between these two qualities. And we started, well, the site was a very arbitrary site. It was a piece of land detached from an agricultural parcel with this kind of already pointing out for some kind of transformation. And we thought that, well, agriculture was once deeply attached to ritual, to rhythm, and then suddenly this ritual dimension was transformed in only effort, sacrifice, sweat. And this condition of sacrificial work was only replaced by industrialization, where the strength of man was replaced by machines. And we never got back to a ritual, we never got back to another dimension. So we thought that we could probably work again about finding a way of imprinting the science of agriculture, but using tools that are not from the agriculture world, they are from a ritual world. So we thought, we called a choreographer, and we tried to imagine with her and with some musicians a moment where a dance could be the instrument of imprinting the agricultural science. So we created these choreographies that would correspond to a first a burning moment, then to a plucking moment, then to taking the bad weeds, I don't know how there is probably a name, and then to a harvest moment, and then to a banquet. So five moments that would sign these 4.5 months, trying to create agricultural marks, agricultural signs, but using a totally different, a urban kind of language, a urban kind of thing. And it was quite funny as an experience. We had to do tricks because we tried to, the dancers, they cannot pull a plug. We discovered that because they are tiny, skinny guys and the plugs are meant to be pulled by bulls and horses, so it was totally impossible to do that. So we had to make the plugging with a tractor and mechanically, and then we would hide ropes, and the only thing that the dancer would do was to bring the ropes up, and when he doing that he would reopen the sign. So there were tricks which were easy, which were not easy, but were very funny to do. But the idea was that this these guys would go across this field, and first they would burn it. We had this kind of circle, which was a landform where people would sit watching this thing and getting together to see those dances and those moments. We work with these guys. They are from Finland, Alamailen Vazerat, and one of the music. Well, they are fantastic. I recommend. And it was a very nice experience. So the guy was plugging and the girl was eating, and this was one of the strongest moments. Then harvesting and everything. Well, but the idea was how to get a performance to become significant as the representation of this gap between two moments, and how to make these two worlds touch in a very particular way. Well, this is another project, and two of our seminar students are working on it. This is Viseu. Viseu is a city in the north of Portugal, and this is one of the famous octagons, the Roman octagons. These are shapes, are marks that probably correspond to military constructions. Nobody knows for sure if this one is one of those or something else, but there are Roman constructions that have this kind of design. It's like a dike, like 20 feet high. And the incredible fact is that this shape, it really resisted to the changing of landscape through to 2,000 years, and everything was changing around it, and the shape was keeping its identity and its presence on this incredibly dynamic landscape. And at a certain moment, we had the possibility of working in two parks. This park, and it was like a water park. It was working in a swamp, and this park, which was it started to be a fair, agriculture fair. Then the contact with the river that was not happening before created an incredible moment, and it became to be very, very popular, and now they don't do the fair anymore here. It's more like a park. But these two situations and another project that a friend was doing here created the possibility of looking at this thing. Well, the thing is that military constructions, when you no longer have a war, they really don't mean anything. They are like a skeleton, and they are very difficult to show and to use. So the difficulty was to give it a new meaning and to attach it to a new system. So we thought that probably if we did this, and if we consider these two parks and the third point here, we could make this become an attachment to the old city center, to the historical center. So the first thing of the project was really to create the conditions to make that become something. Otherwise, it will only be just an old military construction, abandoned and forgotten. And the second part, well, there it is. The second part was what to do with it, because in the 40s, this construction was chosen to represent a totally fake historical construction. They invented a resistant guy that, you know, that 40s Portugal was fascist, basically, and fascist governments, they always invent these national heroes that justifies by genetic the incredible special qualities of the people. And so they were inventing this guy who was a resistant against the Roman invasion, and he was very strong and very brave and all that. And these were his headquarters, a total fake, because the guys that were living in the Iberia were not able to do geometrical constructions. This is something that comes out, an imperial kind of thought. They have to build on a distance. They have to have models and geometry. The guys that were living here, they were building buildings that were totally organic. They were built with stones and with normal gestures. Nevertheless, they did it. They invented this. They created some sculptures of the Viriato with a sword and fighting the Romans. And they gardened the structure, which was really the last thing they should do, because they start to do those benches and lights and the little edges and all that. And they tried to build a garden in something that nobody would never use, because you wouldn't do 500 meters on one direction to get back again. So, and it was enough to remove the dignity of the construction, because you no longer could see topography, which was precisely the source of that dignity, and you no longer could see the sharpness of the geometry. So it was about getting back to that dignity. It was about trying to cut everything and to get that geometry clear again. But then again, cutting trees, oh, it's so difficult. You try to cut trees and you immediately are on the newspapers, and people consider you a killer, and people start to chain themselves to the trees. So we had to have other arguments. No, really, we had to, okay, we do not touch trees. So, look at that. So what we did was something that had to do with measure and had to do with the reclaiming that dignity through the juxtaposition of another element that was very sharp and very clean, and that would recover the possibility of reading this thing and measuring this thing. So we just clean thing, leaving the trees, we clean everything else, and we started to show up by applying a very homogeneous kind of seeding. And then we overlap this structure that is so clear and so sharp that really recovers that dignity and enables people to understand the perfection of that geometry, which is exactly what we did. Then we tried to find ways of rebuilding the gaps and, well, finding strategies of covering the pieces that were already gone. So it was like an idea, a very basic idea that had to get different faces as it was solving different momentaneous problems. So it's like if two different times were just overlapping but not touching, they are creating a relation, but just by the fact that they are close to each other. And I will just tell you the story of this one, then I will go through the images very, very quickly. This is a park, it's a lost competition for Belgium, and it was a World War I site, and they were worried because, and they, it was an open call, so it's a process of competitions that they have in Belgium. They just launch ideas. Some communities, they get to the Baumeister and they say, well, we have this problem, and they make it become a competition. So they each year publish like 250, 300 different themes. And people can, offices, but also ordinary people, if they have an idea and a solution, they just write five pages and they describe the idea and they submit it, and they can be called to develop things in another phase of the competition. So this is the second phase of the competition, and we thought that we could propose a park, so we talked about very vaguely on that. However, we were chosen to develop the second phase, and on the second phase we went there, and this is the village, one of the villages in this site before the war, and this is the village during the war, so you can imagine the violence of the erasing of all those signs, and this is the reconstruction, which is strange because it like slightly moved things. They were building on the site, aside from the original building of everything. So it was a really strange thing, and it was so radical. And we started to move around and to talk to people. And we understood that the idea of forgetting was very much volunteer. It was not an accident. It was not just happening. The only way of surviving was to forget. So we found ourselves in the contradiction of having this competition that was trying to remember something that everyone was trying to forget. And we thought, well, probably, as we are talking about landscape, and landscape has this possibility because we can work on landscape with big bulldozers and changing big volumes of earth and everything, but we can also change dramatically landscape only by writing a book or a newspaper article, or by discovering something about environment, or by doing a television show where we can show people that when they are eating olive oil or butter, they are financing to totally different kinds of landscape. And this actually can have. So we thought, well, so landscape, it's about perception, it's about reading things. Well, let's make a park with two tunnels, with two paths, one that covers memory, and it touches every element, every memorial element of this landscape. So you go and see the bomb that didn't explode, and the crater of the other that explode, and the symmetry and the monument and all that. And aside, we can cover exactly the same territory with a path that touches everything else. So you can build two totally different imaginaries out of this experience. And we thought it was interesting. Yes, but why don't you make them touch? Why don't we make them connect? Okay, that's a good idea. So we could bring some measure to put them together. So we started to call artists and to invent references, very, very abstract references, that if you come from the memorial side, they are clear references to the war. If you come from the other side, they are just art things, but they make you wonder. So it could be a good way, and we structure it like that. And it was very, very funny. It was very, very good to do. Well, we talked about the soil and the condition that the soil, it's the last container of everything. Memorials, well, this is, it is a trench war. So it is a very stupid war. Guys were there for 4 years in a trench, moving like 50 meters up and forth, and the other guys were 1.5 kilometers apart, doing exactly the same thing, and they were just bombing each other for 4 years. So it's what was really, and during those 4 years, incredible things were happening because people were living there. So we discovered that there was a Pakistani group of guys that were there from the Commonwealth, and they were all killed, 35,000. But some guys were writing a cancioneer, a songbook, and the songbook, they send it to Pakistan, and it became very popular. So we got it from Pakistan, and those musics, they could actually be heard because you enter the a clearing in the forest, and we would open that clearing, and when you got that on that clearing, you can listen to that music. So it was a way of, in a very abstract way, recalling that thing. And other beautiful ideas. We worked both with Portuguese and Belgium artists, and well, this is José Pedro Croft, and he always works with the time things, with growing trees and with stone and the soil. This is Miguel Branco. Well, we realized that we were on a cast error. When we, one of the guys of the jury said, "What does a black horse sculpture without a head has to do with World War I?" I said, "Okay, that's not our competition." Okay. Well, the other themes. This is Lisbon again, the most beautiful city in the world, and this is a project about layering. This is on a valley. It was a Ortage production valley, a beautiful place. These are images from the 700s. And it was not a real production place. It was more like a park, because you can see that people were actually wandering on those fields. And there is an image, I think I already passed it, where you can see that aristocrats are walking there. So it was like a fresh place where, when it was hot, people would just go there for a walk and for to enjoy the perfumes of the tomato growing and all that. And tomato was already there in the 700s. Well, suddenly there was a change in this valley, and the valley was kept in this incredibly Arcadian kind of condition until the 20th century, and in the 30s of that century, this bucolical image was totally erased to implant a very strong infrastructure, a road, an avenue, and the river was put inside a tunnel. It was tunneled, and at the top they were covering it with a new layer of earth, and they were designing a modern avenue. These are the phases of this process. That's the avenue. This is a postcard, which is incredible, because the collective imaginary was replacing the representation of that valley as an Ortage park and they were admitting the progress as a beautiful thing to celebrate. So it was really done with conviction and consent. Well, after, in the very same valley, all the infrastructures were applied, the infrastructures of the access of the first bridge across the river in 66 were also on that valley. And then in this location, the first sewage water treatment plant was built in the 80s. And in the 2009, I guess, a competition was launched to design a new sewage treatment plant. And it was a very, very high technology one that at the end produces drinkable water. It was quite frightening to see those guys. They were showing up the technology, and we see everything getting in, and that at the end they take a glass and they drink it. Very impressive. And at the end it is a building. So it is a big building, totally closed, enormous, because it's a building this big. And this is a block of Lisbon. So talking about a building that is as big as 8 blocks of the city, it's quite impressive. But when we start to look at it as a, not as a building, but as a topographical operation, and when we start to understand that this could be also an opportunity of working as something that solves the problem of the construction of the first generation sewage treatment plan. So our topography could be like a prosthetic element, something that actually can rebuild topography, something that actually can add conditions to this valley. So the designs of the building itself started to be not only dictated by the conditions of the technical instruments that have to be under it, but also by the fact that this should be shaped accordingly to a topographical order. And we were really fascinated because we were looking at the cover, which was an enormous, huge cover of concrete. We started to look at it as people look in the artificial agricultural soil construction in many agricultural situations. So we did what the agricultures did. We started to organize the way that we would occupy this enormous surface of concrete with artificial ground to grow stuff. So we set a very mechanical kind of approach, keeping a rigid height on those walls between terraces and a rigid slope of each terrace, and we started to work as these guys did on the construction of these artificial soils too. And the result was like a design that would show the topographical condition of the slope of that big calotte, of that big surface. The big pixels, they were showing a more flat situation. The smaller pixels, they would show a more steep slope. And we wouldn't touch with our terraces the edge by trying not to show the limit of the building, because we really wanted it to merge on context, and it works fine, as you will see on the photographs. So this is the last plan. It is quite frightening, because this is a buzz. So we are talking about something that was this big, and this is the result. And actually, it's like making it disappear. And well, the only facade, because the real facade is the cover, the only facade becomes like a sliding surface, because it's like a archaeological operation on reverse. We are actually getting the contemporary layer, and we are like proposing that it goes to a position that corresponds to something of the past, and we get something from the past, even if it is abstractly represented, and we put it as the contemporary layer. So it's quite interesting, and I think that it shows really well the enormous freedom that landscape architecture has in manipulating these things. And we have to keep this freedom as something very precious. I go very fast, as you can see. Now, this Lisbon, beautiful, most beautiful city in the world, and it's a project that I did with João Gomes da Silva, who is my partner in many works and teaching. And it's funny because one of us is always called the other João. And it depends which. And it's also about layering. And I like to show these projects together, one after the other, because they are both about layering, but they show a totally different kind of approach. And this is a location in Lisbon. This is the square, the Praça do Comércio. This is the Baixa downtown. This is Chiado. And this is the site. And as you can see, it's something that is very strangely structured by a road that shouldn't be there, because this is a very scenographical construction, and people should enter by this side through a very scenographical kind of approach. You are compressed between buildings, then suddenly it explodes with an opening, with a void on your left, then again you are compressed, and then it explodes through the light and through the sound in this enormous space. So it's really controlled. It's like opera. It's really a fantastic construction.
When you enter on this side, you ruin everything. So this didn't exist, as you can see, and it was dramatically built in the 50s with very perverse intentions, and it created this kind of forgotten space that was like this, and it was really nothing, and it's unbelievable. We had this condition until 5 years ago, right next to one of the most iconical plazas of the city. It's unbelievable. Then I was taking photographs, and there were these guys, and she was Danish, he was Portuguese. They were pretty much spoke, but they were sharp enough to find out one of the major qualities of that space. Now, I talked with them, she immediately composed the song to me. But they were able to understand this beach condition and the incredible capacity that this place could be, even if you need to be very, very abstract minded to be able to read it in this context. So we try to get deep into history, and we always try to do that, because we try to understand what that site was and what transformation processes were. So we found out that, this is the place where the caravels, the discovery boats were built. So it was a very important place in the kingdom, and this is the city before the 1755 earthquake, so it was a medieval, quite mazed city with three openings: the construction boatyard, the Terre de Passe, the Royal Palace Plaza. This is the Royal Palace. This is the customs, and this is the market. And it's unbelievable because this is like the diagram of the country. We build boats, we go to get gold and stuff and pepper, then we get it back, we pay taxes here, we sell the product there, and the money goes to the king. So it's perfect gear, really clear. And the layout was kept for many, many years, and you see that the dock, the big dock, this is the Royal Palace, the big dock, the small dock, two ramps. This is already after the earthquake. It's the layout, the new layout of Lisbon. And on the most recent landfills, this is 856. The first landfill of the city was that. This is the old coastline, this is the new coastline. And they were exactly keeping the same layout for this place. One dock, big dock, small dock. Now this is no longer the Royal Palace, it's another thing. Then a second generation of landfills, and this is kept exactly the same. So it's like a very persistent kind of mark. So it's something that is kept alive through time and through the very different shapes that city goes on. Iconography could confirm the importance of this. Here we see the boats being built, others being maintained, the Royal Palace, and the palace of the intendant of the boatyard construction. After the earthquake, the iconography confirming, and we really have photographs of this place before the changing. and we can see this very active kind of place with boats and sailors and movement and some boat construction. This is the last king and the last queen. He was important to measure the height of the old lamps. He was very, very small. So this is the boat being built and being launched in those lamps. This was a tri-rock that was used to repair boats. And suddenly, the road was built in the 50s. It was not a very sensitive kind of operation. They really destroyed everything. But our bet was that everything was still there. And that the guys that were, well, when they were already building this, you could see that the mast crane is still there. So those guys didn't change anything. So they just covered it with a layer of sand that we could very easily dig again. So the bet of the project was precisely that, to create a condition where we were in this incredible position, which is the only place where the old city touches the river, because everywhere else it has this stripe of infrastructural land between it. And we redesigned those signs, and we tried to rebuild them, giving them a totally different meaning. And here we would build the new coastline. So this means the past, and this means the future. And the future would be a beach, of course, trying to use the knowledge that we got from those two guys that you just saw. So the idea was to move over the limit of the city of the river and to create this artificial beach, and to redesign the position of the historical coastline by rebuilding the dock, by rebuilding the two ramps, and by trying to dig the dry dock back. So, and in the middle, this space where, well, transitorily we can move cars, but it should be pedestrian. And here, a bridge would detach the two spaces that are very promiscuously put together by that road. So it's very important, this detaching, this very formal plaza with this area, which should be more relaxed, much less formal. Okay, these are the elements that I just... I might be like 5 minutes late, I think, I'm sorry. These are some images of a construction site, and it was quite a foolish thing to do, because we didn't have any kind of archaeological confirmation that things were actually there. So it was kind of a relief when we started to dig that things were just coming out. And it was a beautiful room of the construction. And we really found incredible stuff, from tiny little objects to beautiful structures that were pretty much in good shape. And archaeologists were working along with the landscape construction guys, and everybody was formed in order to understand what to do, and a precious stone was coming out. And it was a really beautiful moment. And at the same time, in the waterfront, we were like moving on the water and building this new beach. And it was also a fantastic construction. So we could really have this surface and trying to enjoy the new qualities of the river, because the water sewage treatment plant was already working. So we had a very good water quality here. This is the opening moment, where boats arrive and try to... Now we have a problem, because everybody wants to take a bath there, and it's not really a beach. So we have always the police that tries to know, no topless, please get out of the water. Papers are always saying that it was not a good idea. But people use it really, really, really a lot. It's one of the most used places in Lisbon, one of the most successful public spaces, and that's a real honor. this is the last one. It's an ongoing project, and I'm very excited about it. It's on the Palatino. And, well, this is something that I think is quite interesting, because some elements which we work, they have this capacity of holding form and like becoming the records of different shapes of the world. And this is a storytelling thing. And when you are watching these kind of elements, they are coming out from everywhere. And you can really understand what changes, and you can really understand things by reading this very, very modest size. So we are working here in this beautiful mess, and this is one of the plans of Bonnie. This is where everything begins, and it's quite a thrill to talk about this place. This is the place where Rollo and Ramo, they are the two guys that come from the mythical world. The father of Rollo and Ramo is still a god. And so this is like a passage, you know? And now we are on humanity, they touch ground, and they plug the big sign of the Roma Quadrata, and they invent this idea of a city that is built on the capacity of receiving everyone that is escaping from something, slaves, outlaws, they would be out welcome. Well, obviously they built a city of man, so they had to kidnap the Sepainas in order to have to grow. But this is the beginning of the of what we are. And then when we look at this idea of continuity, when we look at this idea of humanity, when we look at this idea of building a very complex set of values that make us a little bit better willingly than the guys that were living 2,000 years ago, and that will make ourselves better than us, I think that this idea has an incredible starting here. And, well, this started as a challenge that was launched by the Soviet Intendenza, a visit, and they wanted my opinion about the way that the visit in Palatino was taken care of. And I went there and I was really very, very worried, because it's so hostile. People are just left there, like in a military field. And they don't have water, they don't have shadow, they don't have a clue about what they are seeing. And they are very happily photographing everything, but they are deeply unhappy after half an hour of excitement. And you can see that there is an incredible potential of communicating the meaning of this site that is totally lost. And you see that people get there, and they, after half an hour, they are tired, or the baby wants to pee, and you don't know where, and the other son wants to drink water, and you don't have water. So, and there is like a total rejection to contemporary, and it is, again, a little bit naive, because this was managed by archaeologists since the 19th century, and they always resisted to the imprinting of a contemporary sign, like if this was like some kind of thing sealed and frozen in time. But when we start to look at the story of this thing, it's nothing at all like that, because every emperor that was building his palace here, he was building it over the palace of the guy that was before. And his idea was not to celebrate the past, but to erase it as much as possible, and to make his palace become the real wonder by destroying what was lying beneath. And this made an incredible construction. And when they asked me at the end of the visit, what do you think? What is the Palatino? I said, well, the Palatino is not a mountain. It's a building. Palatino is a building. is an artificial construction, and it is totally impossible to understand where man-made thing stops and natural thing begins. It's a mess. It's impossible to understand. Well, then I started, what to do, how to move myself, where to work with. It's impossible to work in this mess. And I understood that between these constructions, and very much unlike Greeks, Romans were pretty much self-centered in the constructions that they did, so they didn't really care much about context. They were like self-centered buildings that were floating in space, and they didn't create real relations with the building that was next door. So these structured gaps and forgotten spaces between the buildings, and this construction is very funny because the palaces that were actually designed by architects, meaning eternity, and trying to touch eternity, they were destroyed 25 years after because the other emperor was applying its palace over the other one. But the interstitial space, that was left alone, and it's the only permanent thing in all this construction. So it's a fantastic revelation of a totally upside-down logic in the construction of this thing. Well, so it was about interstitial space, and it will be about that, how we can get this body of three-dimensional interstitials that were left over by each construction, that are the only spaces where we can touch, because archaeologists don't let us touch anything else, and it's the only way where we can move and look at the other things. So it's a very, very complex construction, but a beautiful one that I hope I will get over. I will just go through these images, and well, this is Spitzen's pyramid of words, which is pretty much the same thing. The theme of the invented mountain, which you can all recognize. And you can see the history of the Palatino. It gets more and more complex, and palaces get bigger and bigger. The last palace of Nero covers all the mount, and it's called the Vanus Transitoria, and it is done by changing the shape of the old palaces and designing new things over. There is a beautiful image here that shows that this is the Pyrenees idea, and this is the idea that actually reveals the idea of this interstitial space, where actually we move. But this interstitial space is treated like little gardens, and it's so fragmented, so it's about erasing everything and trying to change that character into something that is really one solid thing, just one solid thing. Look how they are really miserable. So this kind of approach, which is really random and not organized, and tries to create this a little scale, a fragmented scale, that actually does not enable us to understand what we are doing. And they are convinced that contemporary science are not entering this, but they are, because you need rules, you need regulations, you need accessibility, you need fire extinguishers, you need everything. So contemporary enters on the pores, and when they look at it, it's there, it's all over. So, we have to take it as a fact, and we have to find a way of working all this together to invent a new way of using this. So we try to trace the construction of the imaginary of that thing, because we are actually moving against something that is so solidly implanted in the mind of people. And it starts here, it starts with the Grand Tour, it starts with the engravings of the Grand Tour, it starts with Turner, it starts with all these guys, and it's really heavy to move back. So we kind of invented a strategy, and we said, well, this project is about admissibility. Admissibility, can we say that? Well, to become it admissible by people, to become acceptable. So it's about communication, and it's about building a system of getting it so deeply communicated, so It's about acceptance. So we are starting a process where we are moving basically a system of prototypes, and we are building 10 prototypes each year, and those prototypes, they should test physically in one-to-one scale the new conditions that we are trying to propose, and we just left them there, and people will touch it, and people will compare what we are proposing to what we do. And so it is something that will be extended in time. Perhaps we will take 3 or 4 years to cover everything through the kind of prototypes that we want to invent. But by the end, people will have digested those processes and they will have accepted them. So it's very interesting because this is at the same time something that works physically with a landscape transformation and with a mind transformation, a form of this transformation. So it's so synthetically, one of the archaeologists asked me, well, no, that's a good idea to look at the Palatino as a building, and also because a palazzo, it comes from the Palatino, so it has the very same origin. But again, Palatino is the mountain that was offered to Pallas, which is the Greek god of shepherd. And I said, yes, you're right, but you are looking at shepherds in a very bucolic, picturesque kind of image. A guy long with a white tunic running around after the sheep with a flute. Don't look at it that way. Try to look at it as domestication. What really Paulus gives to the man is the gift of domestication, and this is a domesticated mountain, which is an idea that I think is clearly a synthetical one to finish my lecture. Thank you so much for your patience. This is the rocks of the future. There is an artist called Jean-Pierre Brass, and he collects this sediment in the rocks. He goes on the rivers and the sea, and he finds these things that integrate entropic elements, but they are actually already conglomerates sedimentary rocks. So he manipulates them, he polishes them, and he uses them like natural rock. And he says that, well, these are the sedimentary rocks of the future. And this is very much this idea about building the future where, well, nature will only be another thing. Thank you.